Okay, so first thing is that we inside, well, the people who has the web interface set up, they just can watch, but the people who has the actual virtual machine, now please open web browser. And okay, and you have to open the web browser inside the virtual machine. So, and Google something like GRASS addon workshop. Let's try that. Okay, so the, for me at least, the first thing is Wenceslaus Python GRASS addon. And if you go there, that's a GitHub website, and there is this link download zip. So please do that. And that's the website with the workshop. It's available, so you can have a look at it later and so on. And download and let's do save file. Okay, this was fast, and well, Firefox here, it will offer us just to open the directory, so let's do that. And in downloads, I have the zip file, so if right click, I do extract here. And then I got this folder, and inside the folder there are the files, 1, 2, 3 and so on, which are the files we have seen on the website. And we can leave it in downloads. I can't. Okay, so once again the web page. So if you Google something like GRASS addon workshop, you can also add GitHub, for example. And on the website there is download zip. Okay. And just save it. It will offer if you want to open it or so. So just save it. And then from here, here are all the downloads and you can open the folder where the zip file is. And then with right click on the zip archive, you do extract here, and I already did that, so I have the folder there with all the files I need. Well, is everybody there? Anna, can you
raise your hand if you're stuck? Raise
your hand if
you need more time. A couple people need more time. Did I need? Did I need more time? So, since you're using the URL, this is what they're unzipping.
Oh, okay.
So, if you were to want to do this later,
Downloads directory is fine. Well, you can move it wherever you want, but for now. Well, why are we downloading it? Is that these files, these individual files, are individual IPython notebooks. So actually on GitHub, if you click on it, It will take some time, but it will render the IPython notebook. It's not interactive, it will like not run the Python code, but it will render it nicely. Since you are advanced Python people, you can also look how the raw file looks like, not the rendered file, and you will see that it is actually a JSON file. Well, you don't have to deal with that. I'm just showing to that you see what's inside. Oh, whoa, what I'm doing. So like the text which is on the website is actually here, but it's nicely rendered on GitHub. So you can just use these steps, and you can use them like in GRASS Python shell or something. You don't have to do it in IPython notebook, but IPython notebook has some nice features like that. You can nicely save it, you can write your notes there, and they are more fancy than just comments in some script or something. Well, so
I think everybody's ready to go.
Okay.
Yeah.
So well, I can just close it. And so here in the bottom there is terminal. You might have used it when you were installing the guest editions before. So start the terminal. And well, there would be probably some other way to start the GRASS, but I don't remember it. So just go there and type something like GRA. And if you press tab two times, well, it's
right here.
Okay, so well, if you just type GRASS and then press tab, it will give you this GRASS 7.0. And just press enter to start it. And it will give you this GRASS GIS startup window. Where you select which database you want to use, and then the GRASS database is organized in the way that there are locations and maps. And we won't really deal with that now, so I won't go into details if you don't know it. But
so the folks that are running this from the web page URLs that you gave them don't need to.
Oh yeah, they don't do this because this is already like done for them. And select the there. It will be on the OSGeo live machine. Everything is selected, so you can just do start GRASS session. And we get this graphical user interface, which we won't use today. And we will get back to the command line, which is still there. And in the command line, we have to navigate to the directory where we downloaded and unzipped the files. So to change the directory, we use command cd, then space, and then I have it in downloads, so if I type D-O-W and press tab, it will give me, it will like autocomplete the downloads, and then if I press tab again, it will even give me the folder where everything is unpacked, so just press enter. And then just to ensure or like make sure that the files are there, we can do ls to list the files in the directory. Oh well, the files are there. You don't have to do this step, but it's better to see that the files are actually there. And then then type IPython space and notebook. So this is the step where we are starting IPython notebook inside GRASS session. So that's the trick how to tell IPython where the GRASS Python packages are and so on.
So you cd to where the files were, then you launched GRASS from within. So it was like you typed GRASS to start.
I typed GRASS, this was the first thing when I start terminal. But it really doesn't matter,
okay,
because
Oh, I see. You CD'd inside of GRASS.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's the same as CD before starting GRASS.
Okay.
And then starting GRASS.
Okay.
The important thing is that, like, we are in GRASS. We know it. At least here is like the command line prompt. If you make it bigger. So the command line prompt is like GRASS. Then there is name of the current location. That's a part of the GRASS database. And then there is this, the other text is the current working directory where we are. And this is very similar to standard command line. It just has this addition of telling us that it is in GRASS session and in GRASS location. Okay, so.
So when you do your homework that I gave you, you'll be launching IPython Notebook from the index command window. But now you're launching it. This is launching it from within GRASS, which is why we needed this virtual environment. So that it would talk to the right
Python.
Can we say
that it's in GRASS in the command window?
Say that again?
It will be stating that it's in GRASS in the command window?
Not when you do it for the homework. The homework is much is simpler. We're not using GRASS. So there's an executable called ipython.exe somewhere in the right place that is, the virtual machine knows where that is.
Yeah, well, it's technically not exe.
Whatever. It is. Well, it is on not on this machine,
not
but
on the machine.
On the machines that when they're running their homework, yeah. It's going to be an exe.
Okay, so IPython space notebook.
This is a Linux.
And when I run it, it will actually show me a browser window with all the files again. But now it's actually IPython notebook. And the people who were using the webway, this is where you are. So at this time, you can start to follow. So let's start with the first one. So is everybody there? You should see introduction to GRASS.
Yeah.
Oh, you don't have any data. Okay.
I needed to install it again.
No.
Like the GRASS. I needed to install it.
You know how to download the sample data?
Where is it?
From the website.
Oh, from this.
So, do that. So is everybody there?
I can say no. Go back to your camera. You're excited, GRASS? Yeah, you're starting GRASS. Okay, so now you should be able to type IPython. Are you CD to the directory where your data is?
Where is
CD
to
it?
We need
the CD to
Well, the point is that when you are in typing the directory, you don't type it. You just type first letters and then you press tab, and you are pressing tab as long as it will give you something you want.
So, where are you now?
Well, I'm in.
Oh, it's like when you press tab, it will give you the options.
Yes, I can start a new terminal just to show you. So, well, I'm not sure actually if you see it. So now I'm actually in home directory because that's the default directory where you start, so that's how I know it. And I type cd space, and then I know that my data is in downloads, so I do d. It's case sensitive because it's Linux, so capital D, and then I press tab once and nothing happens. So I press it again, and they give me options, what are all the folders starting with D. So I see desktop documents downloads. Okay, so for downloads, I have to type two letters, OW, and then type again, and it will autocomplete. And then in downloads, I'm not sure which folders are there, so I just press tab, and it will actually autocomplete the folder which is there, because there is just one folder, so there is nothing else which it can suggest, so it will just autocomplete. And now, for example, when I press tab again, it will give me some strange folder which is there. I don't want that, so I can just delete that.
Okay.
And then enter, and you are there.
So now you should.
And this works with other things too, like if I would be starting like Python script or something, and let's say I would have in it will autocomplete whatever name I put there. So there are actually some Python files there. There is this file. So again, I'm just like typing as few letters as possible and then pressing tab.
The beauty of the command line.
Yeah. Yeah, so the point in command line is that you don't type, not that you type things. So that's a common misconception.
Soundbite. So then, so he's still at that point. So then he needs to launch grass, and then.
Let me do it in the window again. So you launch grass if you type something like grass. Well, it must be the same thing, but just the beginning must be the same. So, for example, GRASS. And when I press tab, it will autocomplete the command which is there for grass.
So then it launches the grass interface.
Then it launches grass interface, and you select. You select the default what is there in this case, and start grass session. I won't do that now. And it will give you the graphical user interface. Like this.
So you have to do that. You have to start the grass session. You have to have that graphical user interface running.
No. You actually, what you can do, I'm just doing this because it's more simple.
Okay.
But you can set with grass command. Let me show you. If you type grass 70 space -- help, it will give you all these instructions how to run it from the command line, and how to set the database location and map set from the command line.
Right. Okay, so this example is getting a log file sound. So
we
can just
Probably because it was already opened or something.
Yeah,
so just do yes.
Then everything
is just do yes.
Yeah, so just do yes.
Okay. And then you can type by Python.
Yeah. And then
space.
Yeah, I will just do it in this command line, but
I can see it here, but it's kind of hard to read.
Yeah, this is just
so it's easier to read.
Like
okay, so if you press enter after IPython Notebook, it will jump from the command line and it should open a new tab in a web browser. And there is a list of all the IPython Notebook files in the current directory, and the current directory was the thing we used cd for.
Right.
So that's the, for me, is directory in downloads.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is this list of all the IPython notebooks, and well, click to the first one, and you will get here.
Take a little time for it to launch.
No, this is quite
it's immediate. So it can think.
Well, on this machine, it was fast.
Should probably bring your password.
But it depends what it is saying in the command line, right? If it is
something failed, that's fine. It's running.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
You're out on the web page.
And it has, well, if you don't have your browser open, it will have to start the browser first, so it will take some time.
contact service to your front of your right project.
So you have to issue the files, right? Okay, so you have that.
Yeah.
And you have the sample data?
Yes.
Okay. So, since we are still waiting, we won't get through the whole tutorial, of course. It is for 4 hours, not counting the preparation time. So, let me just tell you that the first part is like the most common scripting tasks in Python. Then the second part, which we might get to, is let's say more low level or like finer scale API, where you can with the scripting approach, you use GRASS modules. GRASS functionalities split into modules. You could also call them tools or something. And with scripting, with the scripting API, you just call the individual modules. While with the other API, which is called PyGRASS, you can do like finer level operations, like manipulate the individual features in a vector map, or change values of individual cells in a raster map. And this would be very, in general, it would be probably very, very slow to do this in Python, but the PyGRASS API, it actually wraps around the C library API. So C is, of course, the language where most of the GRASS functionality is implemented in, because it's very fast. But it's very hard to use. And you can use actually the functions from Python using C types, if you ever heard that. But it's still quite difficult. You basically have to know both Python and C to be able to use it. But with PyGRASS, all these things are hidden from you, and you use nice Python, Pythonic object-oriented interface, and you can manipulate like the individual cells in a raster map and individual features and so on. Then the next part of the workshop is creating a script. Maybe I should do it a little bigger. Creating a script, and there, maybe if you will be doing it by yourself or something, there are like the typical steps you do when you are actually writing a script for GRASS. Then the next part is, and we definitely won't do that, but it's worth looking at, it's how to do, how to turn your script, your simple script which you are using on your computer, how to turn it in actual GRASS module, which would be good enough to be put to GRASS add-ons, like to be available to other users. And there are advantages in doing that. One advantage, and you can just do it for yourself without actually publishing it, is that you can get a nice interface for your module. And the interface, I mean both command line interface and graphical user interface. So you can get nice graphical user interface for your users, and you can also get nice interface in command line with like parameter checking and so on. And this interface can be also right away used in Python too. And then there are some usual topics which you will hit with scripting, like parallelization. So there is also a notebook which discusses that, and then there is like a big different API for working with temporal data. So in GRASS GIS you can have like not only 2D rasters but also time series of 2D rasters, and vectors, you can have also time series of vectors, and there are also 3D rasters, so you can have time series of 3D rasters, so you can have like FOSS4G or something like that data, and you can use access this functionality through GRASS modules, but you can also access this functionality through this Python API, which is like more advantageous in some cases than using the modules, which is also possible. And well, in the next steps, there are some other more advanced things. One particular thing is worth looking at, and that's how to test your script. So so in Python there is, for example, unit test package, and for GRASS I actually created a special package for Python, which is for testing the results of your module. So if you write a script or module, you run it, and then like you are interested if the results are good, if the module actually finished successfully, and so on. And you want to automate that, because like testing manually, it works, but maybe at some point you realize that it is not the ideal thing, then you can use this automated way. Okay, so can we actually start?
Yes.
Good. So select the first one, scripting library. And as I said, the scripting library is for calling GRASS modules. And there are basically four options how to call GRASS modules. One way is that you are just running the module, and it writes some geospatial data to GRASS database, but it is not giving you right away some like textual output, like that it would be writing, for example, mean or standard deviation or something like this. For the modules which have this textual output, for that we have read command function, while the modules without it, that's run command function. And then there is a parse command function, which is for the modules with textual output, but the textual output is in the form of key value pairs, and it will give you right away the dictionary. And we will go through the examples of that. And then the last one is write command. That's for the modules which are actually expecting some textual output from you. And we will see example of that as well. So to be able to call GRASS modules, we first have to import the package, right? So, and in IPython notebook, so that's not related to GRASS, it's related to IPython notebook, to run this code, you can either use this play button, which is run cell, so the individual parts, like here, 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 they are called cells in IPython notebook. And if we have this guy
here.
You have
your focus in wherever you have your mouse clicked in, that's your focus, and that will be what runs if you push the run button.
Yeah, so for example, I can run this heading, and it just shows me the heading. But if I can like double click here, and I have like the raw text, and if I write there blah blah and run it, then I will get this nice text. So the advantage is that you can do something like this, put stars around some text, and you see that it is actually somehow showing me the that it is italics now, but when I run it, it's like nice italics only and so on. And it's using a lightweight markup language called Markdown. So in general, we call these things markups. So this language, particular language, is called Markdown. Okay, so and for Python, so this would be a Markdown cell. Well, this is Python cell, and when we run it, it executes that, and we know that it is executed because here is the number which is like the order in which it was executed. So when we execute it again, it was the second cell which was executed. We don't know that it was executed already, but well, we have to remember that. So, and then I think you can run it also with Control Enter. Okay. So, of course, you want to.
Inside virtual machine, it's Control Enter. Okay.
Yeah. Well, it worked for me.
Okay. On our Windows machines, it's Shift Enter.
Oh yeah, maybe Shift Enter will do also something.
Control-enter.
So Shift Enter also works. I'm not sure what's the difference.
Okay. Just where you want to put your little pinky finger.
Okay, so the first command you usually should run when you are working interactively in GRASS, like in graphical user interface or command line, it should be g.region for setting the computational region, which mostly applies for raster computations. Like it, right, it limits the raster computations and it sets the right resolution you want. So in this case, we want the resolution and the extent to be the same as this elevation raster map or elevation raster layer. So if I do control whatever, control enter, it will run it. And here actually, it, unlike the import, this guy has some output. Well, in the case of run command function, it's not really important. So I will just skip that for now.
Just for the context, they're setting the region and all that for the data that they picked when they first launched. I mean, they're going to be in the context of the data that they first, when they first launched GRASS, they picked a default data set, right?
Yeah, so when we are starting GRASS, for the people who are using the virtual machine, we selected GRASS database, and the GRASS database has two different parts. It's a tree, but like first you select location, which are all the data in one projection or coordinate system, and then the location is divided into map sets. And we selected one map set, which is called user one in the virtual machine. And you usually use the map sets for your particular work. So for example, for our workshop, we could create a new map set and it would be Thursday workshop or something like this. So this is how the data are organized. But then when you are doing the computations, all the data are automatically saved in this particular map set and location in the given GRASS database. But this doesn't apply to like how the data, what is the geospatial extent of the data. Of course, it relates to projection, right? You don't compute somewhere where you shouldn't. Like for North Carolina state plane feet, we don't use it to compute something in Europe. But usually compute something like only the digital elevation model in Wake County area or something. So you have to set the region, the computational region in GRASS to match the area of Wake County or something like this. And the region, of course, is it's a raster, so it's always rectangular. So for like Wake County or something, this would be a mask, but we want to go into that direction. So now we already have some data there actually. That's the sample location, which is on the virtual machine. And so just very simply, we just use the current, well, the raster has some resolution and extent already. So we just use this resolution and extent to set the computational region, which is very often what you want, but you might want to change, for example, the resolution, right? Like to be finer or maybe higher. Okay, so first real module which we will use will be this R neighbors. And you see that we imported the grass.script package as gscript. So we are using gscript dot, and then the function name is run command. And the first parameter is the name of the module. It's a string, obviously. And then we use key value arguments to set the parameters. So this is the name of the parameter, and this is the value, as usually as a string, right? Like as a elevation name, layer name, and how you get these parameters? Like what are they? So if you you don't maybe have to do that. I will do that. In a new window, I open this documentation for r.neighbors module, and you see different parameters here: input, selection, method, size. And this documentation, if you will, here is like the syntax. So this syntax is for command line, but it is done in the way that the syntax is almost the same as for Python. So if you see here input equals name, then you basically just write input equals the name. But in Python, of course, the name always has to be string, so it has to be in quotes, while in the command line it doesn't have to be. And then in Python, the individual parameters are separated by comma, and we also put there a space, while in command line they are separated just by comma, and that's it, and just by space, and that's it. You don't put there the comma.
So for those of you that had GIS 540, we did the TK module, sort of like that. You have to specify the name of the parameter equals the value you want to pass
in. Yeah, when we use this, the order of the parameters really doesn't matter, because we are like using the names of the parameters. If we wouldn't be, we would have to have them in the right order, which like with more than two parameters is almost impossible to guess right. So, and then one special thing here is that here is this parameter flex, and if you look here, here is no parameter flex. That's here, and that's thing which is different from command line. So in command line you would write something like minus a, but in Python obviously there is no such an option. You know how the syntax works probably. So there is this special parameter flex, and you just put all the letters there as a string. So if I would be putting there both a and c flex, I would put c and a there. Okay, so well, what it is doing is that it is basically smoothing based on average the elevation map, and it is creating this elevation smoothed raster. So when I run it, and again, I don't see any result now. And well, in GUI, it would probably, after the computation, you would see the result, right? But in Python, you of course don't see the result, and usually when you are scripting, you usually don't like show the results right away. You show the results at the end. But when we are doing like this interactive session, like in command line, or in this case in IPython notebook, we want to see it. So there are several options, and we are actually considering putting some of these options into GRASS to be readily available, but they are not available now. So with the version of GRASS we are using now, what we have to do is there is a file actually. We will see it. No, not here. Okay, I can show it here maybe. There are some Python files inside the directory. So the file is called render, and here we are actually using this file And there is a function view, which we will use for viewing the data here in this interactive session. So if I run it, it will import the function, and it also calls the function with parameter rasters. And in the list, we put there just one raster which we want to show. And voila, it shows us the map inside the IPython notebook. So people actually argue that this is the way how we should do scientific papers, that you have the headings, description of the thing, then the code, how you get the thing, like here, and then how you get all the results, all the graphs. You just like have the code even for the graphs there. So there is like, you don't smooth out some like outliers or something, but you actually see what all the results are. And there are actually even web services how to create these interactive papers, but you can do it by yourselves just in IPython. And there is then like something like save as, and you can save it as HTML, for example, but there is also a way how to get it to PDF. Okay, so the next specific thing for the interactive sessions, you shouldn't do this in the scripts, but it's more advantageous, is to set this environmental variable. So this is the way how in Python we are setting the environmental variables. These are like the variables in the system. You probably dealt with path variable. So this here is special grass variable override. So I will run it, and this will say that if there are some existing data grass and you want to write or like overwrite this data, grass will just override them without actually asking you about it. And then one more thing specific again to the interactive session is that we have to call this function which will say what are, or which will cause that it will, on an error, it will throw an exception rather than end the execution. Whatever that means. If you don't know what that means, it doesn't matter. Okay, so now we are actually ready to start doing something. So I was talking about the commands which are actually returning some text. So there is the command gregion, we used it for setting the region, but with flag p, it will also print the region. So it will print the region. So the function read command will return text, and to actually print it as a text in Python, we use function print. Well, here we use function. The statement would work too, because in interactive session in Python 2, they just do it in the way that both function and the statement are available. Well, if you don't know what I'm talking about, also ignore it. That's the difference between Python 2 and 3. But okay, so gregion minus p, well, when I say minus p, what I mean is that I mean flag p, and it gives us the text from the region. Oh, well. So another example is r.univar that's module for computing univariate statistics, and we give it a parameter map. We set it to the raster we created, and then we run it. It gives us this key value pairs. That's because we are using this flag minus g, and you would read about this in the documentation, that it will give you like shell style output, which is like nicely parsable. So what we could do is that we would parse this text instead of printing it. But since this is like a standard in GRASS, a lot of modules which have this textual output implement minus G flag or some other flag, which will give you this nicely parsable output, which is key value pairs, right? Range equals something, mean equals something. So there's, I don't know what's still happening to me. Yeah. Well, that's probably because I'm using mouse or something. Okay, so there is a function which actually wraps this read command function, and it will right away parse the output when it is key value pairs, and it will put it into Python dictionary. So you probably recognize here are the keys and here are the values. So then of course you can do things like indexing it, so you can just show that when I'm interested in units, I do units. And if I type it correctly, I get meters. Right, so you don't have to parse it, that's the point. Without, well, I really don't know what's happening. That's the wheel probably on the mouse. Without the parsing, just with the read command function, it would give us this text with equals. And then this is a little bit more complicated example. This is a command v in ASCII, which is reading some ASCII XYZ plain text file with coordinates and creating a vector map from it. And in documentation, we would read that if we want to use this textual input instead of, let's say, a file, we would use just minus there. That's a common practice to do that. And in Python API, we put there this std in. This means standard input parameter. And it will feed basically the command or the module with the text we put as std in parameter. What we are doing here is that we put there these two coordinates, but we format them in the way that in between there is this pipe. So this is how, let's say, the default format of vin.ascii works, and the output vector map, we name it viewpoint.
So writing that command creates the new file on the virtual machine?
Yes, this viewpoint. And what I wanted to do is to actually view it. So, well, maybe let me type it so you can also type it with me. So here will be somewhere plus to add a new cell. And there was this function view, and it will, well, okay, IPython even gives me the suggestion what to write there, so vectors. And it was a list, and to the list we put a name of the vector we want to view, so we name it viewpoint, and hopefully this will work.
Just a mini, I think the versions some people are working on don't have the plus sign. You can use the insert menu to insert a new cell.
There's an arrow down, it's a highlighted down or up.
Yeah, that's right.
This is insert.
The interface might be a little bit different for the people who are working on the web version. So I actually got like this big white image with one point in it. So that's exactly what we put there, this one point. Well, I'm not sure if it will work. Yeah, this is what we created. So the take-home message from the write command is that it's possible, like, to feed some textual information into the module, and this particular example is creating a vector map. So this is one way how to create a vector map, and you see that it is maybe a little bit cumbersome. So that's why the PyGRASS interface is much better on some occasions, because we can do the same with PyGRASS, and it is much more like natural for Python, because we will actually use objects and methods and so on. And of course, there are modules which you use a lot with this interface, or the tasks which you repeat a lot. And for this, there are some wrapper functions which make it more convenient to use it. So they somehow like prepare the data, parse the parameters, and so on to make it more convenient. So let's try this vector info function with parameter viewpoint. That's the vector map we just created. And when I run it, it gives me this dictionary with all the different information about the map, like how many areas are there. There should be somewhere that there is one point there. And this is a dictionary, and you maybe recognize that this is the dictionary you would get from the parse command function. So this function behind the scenes, it calls r.info module, v.info module, and then parses its output and shows it as this nice Python dictionary. Another example of that is a raster what function, which is calling r.what module, and this module is telling us what are the values of a raster map on some particular place. And we are specifying here a list of places by their coordinates. So when I run it, I get a dictionary which contains the information about like which map we used, and then like what's the color, what's the label of the raster map according to the value and the actual value. And we put there two different locations, so we have two different, like, this is actually a list of dictionaries, and the value in dictionary is a dictionary. So of course, when you are indexing it, you have to think twice, but somehow it works. Very often you do, especially in scripts, very often you do raster algebra operations, and you could use r.mapcalc module directly, but there are some advantages in using a wrapper for it. So there is this mapcalc function, and the parameter of the mapcalc function is the raster algebra expression. So just not to be confused, this is a different syntax. This is GRASS raster algebra syntax inside the string. So we are creating an elevation strip map based on this condition that the elevation is in between some values, and we are basically just selecting part of the area in this raster algebra expression. But again, this is not Python, this is raster algebra, and you can read about raster algebra in r.mapcalc manual page. And right away we print the univariate statistics of that map. So I'm getting something. I can also, well, I think what I, oh, there, that's a good idea. So I can just look at min. And that's wrong. Oh, I know. Because I'm using, so I tried to index it, right? But I'm using read command function. So it is saying that string indices must be integers, not string. And I'm using, you can of course index string, right, with numbers, but I'm indexing it with string because I thought that it is a dictionary. So of course, what I want actually is function parse command, which gives me dictionary and I can index it. And it contains these things. And the lower value is 100, and which is, that's what we wanted, right? Okay, so different function is a function region, which gives us current computational region. And when we print it, that's a, it's a dictionary of, again, like the different values which regions means. So there is a resolution in different directions, and then like the maximum north, south, west, east coordinates, and also the number of rows and cells and so on. And what we do here is that we compute an area of one raster cell. This is just, we just do it here as an exercise. But when you are doing raster operations, you often do something like this. And the thing to remember in this case is that this works only in projected locations. So in GRASS locations, in general coordinate systems. So only in projected coordinate systems, you have the same cells, right? In latitude, longitude projection, the raster cells, each raster cell has different area based on the position, like latitude and longitude. So you, one way how to get around it is to say, oh, my script or my module doesn't work with latitude, longitude coordinates, always use projected, because, well, for rasters, it makes sense to make this a limitation. With some scripts which somehow manipulate the raster or vector maps, we always want to list them somehow. So there is this different functions list underscore something. So we are here using list underscore grouped, and we are selecting our raster raster maps, and we get this complicated dictionary, which gives us there are map sets as keys. So we are in user one map set, but in GRASS you always also see a permanent map set. That's just how it is. And there are rasters from the permanent map set, and then there are rasters from the user one map set. So these are the ones which we created, like, right, this elevation strip, we do it with the algebra, and elevation smooth, we did it with r.neighbors. And to do something with map sets, there is this GISenv function, which is giving us GRASS GIS environmental variables. So there are system variables, and then there are GRASS GIS environment variables, which are not the system variables, but that's something which GRASS handles for itself. And one of them is map set, which is what the current map set is. And they are written in all caps, as the variables usually are, the environmental variables. And we use it, we use the current map set for the function list pairs. So we used list grouped. So here we will use list pairs, and we limit the selection just to the current map set. So let's see what it will give us. So it gives us name of the map and this is a tuple, right? So that's why pairs, because it's a tuple with two items, and the second item is a map set. And the map set is always the same because we set it that it should be the current one. What we can also do is that we call it just without the map set parameter, and we will get all the different rasters in permanent and user one map sets. And then, well, we can somehow deal with that. So this is, for example, if you would be doing some report or something and you created a lot of different maps and you want to, I don't know, draw a picture or run analysis on all these maps. So there is an exercise, so you can actually do it at home as an exercise, optionally, I guess. All right, not sure.
Or maybe not optionally.
What you showed us.
Well, then, it should be possible to do it. Maybe you have to,
read
you will have to read a little bit more documentation. So that's the scripting part, and well, how much time do we have? Okay. Okay. 11:15, right, or something like this.
11:30.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's
so
great.
Well.
That's great. So I selected a second exercise, PyGRASS library. So PyGRASS, as I said, is wrapping around the C API, so it is quite fast, but it also wraps it in the way which is object-oriented or Pythonic, so it is nice to use it in Python. And well, the interesting information maybe even for you is that it was written, well, the original version, since then it, of course, evolved. But the original version was written during Google Summer of Code. So that's a stipend program from Google where Google pays students to work on open source projects. And the students actually can select the project by themselves. So Google just works with the open source projects, like the open source projects applies to Google, and then students applies to Google, and then it gets sorted out. And usually what you do is that you work with somebody in the project. So either personally or on the internet, you find a project you are interested in and say, oh, hey, I have this idea, or do you have some ideas? I would like to work over summer. And it's over summer so that like you can actually do your study during the school year. Let's maybe skip the description because I already gave some.
Did you mention you get paid?
Oh yeah, well it's it's a stipend program, so you get paid for that. Yeah. Okay, so PyGRASS. It's inside the GRASS package, sub-package PyGRASS, and there are different, it's divided to different parts, and we will use the part which is for vectors. And we will use vector topo class, which is vector with topology. So GRASS GIS, all the vectors are stored topologically, but you at some particular circumstances, you can work with them without topology. Like for example, with points, you don't actually need any special topology for most of the tasks. So you can work without topology, but it's always better to, if you don't know what to use, it's always safer to use the one with topology. So that's what we are using. And then we will use class point, because you will be creating the points. And the task will be the same as what we did before, that we want to write a point to a new vector map. And we did it with the v.in.ascii and the standard input and so on. So first we create an object, vector topo, and we call it viewpoints. And this is the name of the variable in Python, right? And this is the name of the vector map inside GRASS database. So they can be different or they can be the same, it depends. For example, if you would be doing it in a for loop or something, you would probably automatically generate this name, while this name would be still the same, right, in the for loop. So what we have to do is open the map. So there is a function open, similarly to like a file or something. It's a method of the viewpoints object, or the vector topo class. And because we want to create the vector points inside the map, we want to write to the map. So we use mode W for writing. So this will also do all the checks if the map already exists, and it will fail it will if it already exists and so on. But what we did was this GRASS underscore override system environment variable, which just ignores that anything exists and it will just write it. And then we can create the points as objects. So we are creating two points with these coordinates, and we named the variables point one and point two. And then to actually store it in the map, we use function write on the viewpoints object, and the parameter is obviously the point we want to write. And at the end, we always have to close the map to ensure that everything is written on disk and then the files are closed properly and so on. And sometimes, you know, of course in Python there are exceptions and you somehow interrupt the program and so on. So to make it more safe. There is this with statement. So do you think somebody heard about with statement?
Yes, people have already so, heard about with statement.
Also, you use a term context manager with statement, and it works in the way that we use with, and then we like create an object somehow, and we name it using s. So this is similar to this line. But what it will do here additionally, like the object has to support this with statement syntax, and the vector topo class supports that. And it will right away open it in the write mode, which is what we specify here. And then at the end of the with statement, you see that there is no close, because once the with statement will end, which will be here, it will just close it automatically. And when if there is some exception thrown or raised inside the with statement, it will raise the exception, but also it will close the viewpoints vector before it will leave the with statement and continue with the exception state or so. And one more thing we are doing here, which is new, is that we will write. We will write attributes with the points. So here we just we're using coordinates, but when we want to use also attribute table, we first have to specify the columns which should be in the attribute table. So we specify column cat. It's like category or an ID of the feature. And we say, of course, it has to be integer as usually, and it's a primary key in the table. That's in SQL. We are saying that this is the column which is the main one, which should be the indexed one, and so on. And then we put there just one attribute called name, and the name, and it will be general text. So then we are actually using the points we already created before, so you can like reuse these guys. So this is what we are doing, and then we are specifying the attributes. They are specified as tuple, and since the tuple has just one item, in Python you have to put there the comma at the end to show that it is a tuple and not just parentheses. So we say that the first point is pub and the second point is restaurant. So it will take the coordinates from the from these variables, from the points, and the attributes are here in the tuple. And at the end, we have to get the table from the vector map, and in the connection we have to commit the transaction or commit the all the statements to be executed in the database. Well, actually I have to say that I'm not sure how it works with the database and the with statement, but probably documentation would tell us more. So here in the other example, well, I should probably execute that if I want to use it. Okay, so what I am not executing. Okay, I haven't executed anything. So import, then I will need definitely the points, and then I need this writing points with attributes, and then I want to do reading, and I will do it again with if statement. So I'm opening the map, and now I'm opening it in just reading mode. So it expects that the map is there, and it will fail if there is not. And I call the variable points, and then I can just simply iterate over the points using for loop. So for point in points, it will just give me the features which are in the points map, or this viewpoints. And then what I do is print the point and print the point attribute called name. So I'm getting the point, the whole point, including a class, because like this is what I'm printing, the whole object. But the attributes are not printed, and I'm printing just one, and that's the name. And the attributes are stored in the dictionary, as you see. Okay, so this is much like more Python-ic, right, than calling some modules and parsing the interface, or like putting them some textual interface into the modules. But it might be maybe more tricky sometimes, because what you are doing here is that like behind that there is a C library which has to handle these things. So you must be like more precise in what you are doing. Well, with the modules, all the error states and so on are already like taken care of and so on. Yes?
You want to pause for 5 minutes if people want to use the restroom?
Yeah, that's now it's good time actually.
So I just want to put in context that someone, while we had the recording up, someone asked about how this is working with calling GRASS from Python. And so
Okay, so here, what we see here is a v.random module for generating random vector points. And we are setting output vector map, input points, and then number of points, seed with random things we often want or don't want to set some seed. And if we go to the vrandom documentation, which I have already here, zoomed for some examples. So we see here, let's say here, v.random, and here is seed, output, number of points, and so on. And the difference, what you see is that in Python we call a function and the name of module is a string, and then we use keyword arguments, and like for example the name of the map must be a string, the numbers are just numbers. The example is for command line. It will work in Windows command line, like the CMD, in PowerShell. It will work in all Unix command lines. Very often in GRASS documentation, if there is something more complicated, very complicated, it's probably written for Unix command line. It will be probably written there that it is for Unix command line, but like these general commands, they will work just in any command line. It will also work in GRASS command line here or command console. So you can type the commands here.
But when you say it'll work in any command line, you mean you run GRASS in the command line and then inside of the GRASS running
process.
That's a
good point. So on both on Linux and Windows and also on Mac, if you start GRASS, you always get a command line and the graphical user interface. So for example, in our case, we got these two. Well, what we actually did was that we started the command line first, but even if we wouldn't, we would actually get some command line window or terminal, and that's system
right.
command line, which is the same as the one which we would start without GRASS. It has all the functionality of the system command line, plus the GRASS modules or commands. So then these modules or these commands in the manual, they will work in this command line, but they won't work in the system command line. But the type of command line is the same as the system command line. It uses the same syntax, it has the same commands or built-in commands and so on.
So the GRASS, you're showing how to call GRASS within Python, and why is that useful, other than it being beautiful because we all love Python?
Yeah, well, what I was also saying, and let me answer that afterwards, that the Python thing is actually this run command function. It will like process the options and so on, and at the end, it will actually create this command for a command line, and it will call it as a subprocess. It's not opening like command line window where we could type, but it's calling a subprocess, and the subprocesses are called in the same way as you type in the command line. So you can imagine it in the way that it is actually typing it into command line, this particular command with the command line syntax rather than Python syntax, and executing it. So it's like wraps this command line for you into a Python syntax. And the advantage of using like Python over command line directly is that you actually can script in Python. Well, you can script in command lines too, like in Unix, there is, for example, the bash interpreter, which is the command line you get, and you can also write a script for that, which is the same as in Python. You have Python IDE, or how it is called, the interactive interpreter, right? And you can also write a Python script. So the same applies for command line too.
But that allows you to wrap commands, like to do looping and conditional statements in a way that you guys are already familiar with.
Yeah. Python. So the difference for me, at least, is that, okay, well, this is really simpler to write. You just use spaces. You don't care about strings. Everything just works. While in Python, you have all these commas and strings, and the syntax is a little bit different, and you have to put there the name of the function, and so on. But once you start to write something like if statements or for loops, or you want to save some variables and something more complicated like a dictionary, then you can do it in bash command line or bash scripting, but it's much more difficult. Like, the syntax is crazy and you don't want to do that. But it's possible. When I Google it, I can write a bash if statement, and I'm doing it because it's sometimes just more advantageous to use it. But on the other hand, for more complicated tasks, I always end up with Python. And this is when we are calling the GRASS modules. For the PyGRASS library I was using before, that's a different case, because that's using C API. So in this case, it is not wrapping the command line to call GRASS modules, but it's wrapping C library to call GRASS C library functions, which you can't use from command line, but you can use them from Python. So Python can combine all these things together, actually. Okay. So, okay, I have to go to the interactive one, actually.
Record.
Yeah, I started.
We already did that. But thanks.
Thank you. Good point.
So let's, okay, well, I'm skipping here something. So let me just show you. In the PyGRASS, in the second part, there is working with raster data. So you can actually open a raster map in some certain ways, and then you can do like some fancy operations with the whole row, for example, and you can do things. Well, there are actually automatic functions to convert it to NumPy, but you can also write your own, and you can like manipulate the individual rows or cells and so on. But we won't need it for the next example, so I'm skipping it. And then there is also one thing which often confuses people. In PyGRASS, there is also option to work with GRASS modules, but well, if you look at it, it's very similar. We see name of the module and then the parameters and so on. But this way is more object-oriented, so we are actually creating an object, and then we can access its parameters, its attributes. And this is for some like very fine work with GRASS modules, where you want to do something more than just calling them. So unless you know that you have something, oh, I wish the module would be object, you don't need to care about this interface. Because what you probably want is just to call the modules. So this would be too complex for that. But it's there for cases where you need some object-oriented approach to individual modules. Okay, so now we will try to create our own script, combining the things we used before. So this third exercise, create script. And when you open it, you see that we decided to do some exercise where we will analyze view sheds. And we will generate some points. And from these vector points, we will compute a view shed, and then we will combine the view sheds together to do some analysis. So first thing is, again, this GRASS override variable, which is just for the interactive session, so that we can run the commands repetitively, and we can actually override the data because we actually don't care about the data much now. We don't care about losing the data. So we will do the small pieces, and then we will, at the end, we will create a really long script. So first, let's generate the vector points, and using the vrandom, which we discussed before. And what vrandom is doing is that it is, it's generating random points somehow like spread over the landscape. And actually, most of the vector computations, they don't honor or they don't use the computational region, but some of them do. It's always written in the manual. And vrandom is using the extent of the region to limit the area where it is generating the vector points. And we are setting the region using gregion. I'm not sure why we are setting north, east, south, west, east, and raster together.
Limit the region for generating the...
Okay, so here we are limiting the... Well, we are limiting the region using like the whole gregion call, but we are, from the raster, we will take just the resolution for the later computations, I guess. And then we manually specify the extent. So first we will start with what we want to do for one individual point. So in this case, we just created the point by ourselves. Okay, I have to run it to actually get the map, because we will use the maps, the map which is created here with the points, we'll use it later. But here, we are just creating one point by ourselves with the coordinates. We just hard-coded here. And then, what we will do is that we will compute the view shed on an elevation raster or digital elevation model, which is called elevation. And then we will do some raster algebra on it. So, okay, we are not using input points now, but what we are using is this elevation variable where we have the name of the elevation of the digital elevation model. Then we say what's the observer elevation above ground. So we say 3 meters. It's of course in the units of the current location, which means the current projection. Yes?
I will have a question.
Okay. Then we specify the output. We have the name of output in this TMP viewshed name variable, and we just call it TMP viewshed. So just you see that it can be different than the variable, right? Because these are two different things. And then the coordinates from where the viewshed is computed, we take from this variable point, and the function chords will give us the coordinates, I suppose, as a tuple, so two numbers. And this is how the coordinates parameter will just accept that, so that's good. And with this temporary viewshed raster, what we do is that we have this here, mapcalc raster algebra expression. And before, when we used the raster algebra, we just typed in the names of all the maps. But here, for the script, it's more advantageous to actually use the names as we store them in the variables, right? Because then we can just change the name of the map here, and it will propagate to all our code, right? This is why we use variables. So with raster algebra, you can do it in the way that you use string formatting. So we use here this function format on the string here, and the function format works in the way that all the things which are in curly brackets, they are the things which will be substituted when the format function is called. So here the viewshed is here the viewshed key here. So here we are also using the keyword arguments, and for the viewshed key here, we specify that it should be the content of variable viewshed name, which we set somewhere here, and it's actually viewshed. So I hope it's not too confusing. So then this and the expression is basically that if this raster map is if the cell evaluates as true, so it's probably non-zero, then put there viewshed. So that's viewshed ID. So that's the number here. We are just putting there like the ID for the point or something, and this will be useful later. And for all the other cells, we are putting their nulls, because we don't want there anything. So the null values in GRASS raster algebra are created using this null function. Okay, so when I run it, it executes, and well, I'm not sure if we want to actually see some results. We could use the view function, but are you interested in seeing some geospatial data, or do you want just the code?
No, we want to see the
data. Picture.
Okay. So I will copy it from the previous one, and I will create a new cell, let's say. Let me move it here. So, okay. And we created we are creating this viewshed map, which in effect is viewshed name, which in effect is viewshed. Okay, so that. And run. And it's here. Okay, so what we don't know is where the point is, because we don't have the point stored as a vector map. So we can't actually, well, we could draw it with some different displaying technique, but yeah.
It's basically created a mask because we gave a value of 1 to where we have data and then a null value where.
Yes, you can view it as this, or the other way how to view or look at this is that we are masking the viewshed based on basically its value, and we are not using the value of viewshed, but we are using just a constant, which in this case the constant is 1. And this is something which you will do often when you are scripting, or at least if you are working with rasters, right? So you often do some raster algebra and you combine raster algebra expressions and so on. And if you would be doing it in GRASS, then it's probably worth reading the manual, because there are, well, one thing is that there are of course some functions and operators, but the other thing is that there is a syntax possible for like these. You often do like some subsequent computations in raster algebra that you can't like write it as one expression, but you write it as several expressions. But GRASS raster algebra will allow you, when you are using it in this way, that you can write these subsequent expressions to basically to one expression, and it will just on the fly create the maps. So you are not writing the maps to the disk, it's just like everything is computed in r.mapcalc module, so it's much faster because it's just like on the fly, maybe it's the right word.
I had a question.
Yeah.
So sometimes you just write run command and then you state the name of an actual GRASS command. And sometimes, mm-hmm. like when mapcalc, you did not do gscript run command r.mapcalc.
Yeah.
So what's the difference? Why do you use this?
So in theory, I could use also run command r.mapcalc and then expression equals, and then it would be the same. But for some modules, and r.mapcalc is one of them, there is a wrapper function which is more advantageous in some way. So for example, in case of mapcalc, the advantage is that, well, when you will be doing what I was talking about, the like combining the expressions all together to one big expression, then what can happen to you is that you will, if you would just use run command, then what I was saying is that it is translating it to command line syntax and then calling this command line thing. But most of the command lines, they have some limit on the length of the command line. So the command can be just as long as, I don't know, probably something like 1024 or something. But I don't really know. So this function mapcalc actually gets around it by providing this expression as standard input to the r.mapcalc module. So in fact, it is using write command function, not a run command function. But so then you don't have to like remember, oh, should I use r.mapcalc with run command or write command? Oh, for short expressions, run command is fine. For long expressions, I should probably use write command. So the mapcalc function is there that you don't have to remember this. And just you have to remember just that for mapcalc use mapcalc function, not r.mapcalc.
Like, so there is like a list or certain commands that it's better to, because before we did it as well.
Yeah, so well,
and
I don't
how to decide, why to decide.
Where do I have the link to the PyGRASS? Okay, so that's close enough. Well, maybe I can show you if we, well, googling GRASS manual is always tricky. Well, let's
get lawnmowers.
Well, if we go to main GRASS website, that's big, but there is documentation, manuals. And for the user manual pages for 7.0 stable, that's what we want. Okay, the Python is also here, but I actually prefer to do this. And here is... So maybe since you are more advanced, I can tell you that...
I am.
All of you. So just not to be confused, there was that it is GRASS 7 stable and here is GRASS 7.2 SVN. That's just like we decided that it would be better to actually put there like the latest documentation for the 7.0 version. But what you would have installed now would be 7.0.1. But the difference is just so small that the documentation is almost the same. But this documentation contains the, like the latest improvements.
SVN stands for subversion.
Yeah. Well, it really doesn't matter. It's like the development version, but this development version is very close to the actual one. Then there is the real development version, which is like the unstable one. But I'm not talking about that one. So just that you are not confused, or maybe more confused, but you have something to think about. Well, and here is Python. So GRASS GIS Python library documentation. And here's like description of different parts of it. And then there are these different parts. So what we are using is the script package. If you look here somewhere, right? We are using grass.script. So here is this, here's this script package. So, well, let's see what it will give me. So there is script package and it has different parts. So let's just say I want the general one, and then it's divided on to these, but there is always how you should import it, and the things usually don't have to write this second one. This is just how the imports are done, but well, maybe you can at some point look at it. And there are like these different functions. So for example, the array function, where it is somewhere shown nicely, I don't see. Okay. Well, maybe this is the array function is not really a good example. So let's see what we were using. Raster, okay, that's a good idea. So so here is the function mapcalc. It's under raster, so you can either import it in the way that, well, this is a strange way how to import it, but anyway, you can import it in the way that you write raster.mapcalc or gscript.mapcalc or whatever. Well, that's, Python imports are very flexible, so there are a lot of ways how to do that, unfortunately. And well, there are some other functions like dbSelect, which will perform a SQL statement, probably just the select statement. Then test if database table exists. And probably if table is in vector, yeah, if vector has connected, because vectors might have or might not have attribute tables in GRASS. It's not, because sometimes you just don't need any attribute data, so then there is no attribute table connected to the vector, so everything is much faster then.
So getting back to the question was was really when do we use run command versus the specific
these
command
guys
itself. So if it's in this list, then it's recommended to use this versus
yes.
run command.
Yes. And in some cases it's just convenience. So for example, we were using this list group and list something, list pairs functions. So in this case that's just convenience. This might be explained in the documentation, and maybe with the rmapcalc you wouldn't think about it, so you would just use rmapcalc, and at one point it would start behave strangely. So then what you do is that you go to the documentation and look, oh, what to do with rmapcalc, and then you see, oh, there is this function which I should use instead, so you then use this one. But for most of the others, it's like from what I remember, it's just convenience. You're welcome. Okay, so we showed a picture even. That's great. Yeah, and I was saying that the point, we don't have it as a vector map in this case, right? Because it was just, we just created like the object, but we were not storing it in a vector map. So I'm not trying to draw it because it would be more difficult. And then we have like the area, like the this raster map, that's the area which is visible from the point. And we want to, at the end, compute the actual area which we see from that point. but it's a raster, so first step is probably to compute just the cells which are there. And the r.univar, it's returning us the number of cells and number of non-null cells. And well, I'm not actually sure. Let's first try to. So we already used parse command with this r.univar for univariate statistics, and it gives us dictionary with. Okay, so the n is number of cells, and then there is also null cells, which is number of cells which are null. And the statistics is computed just on the non-null cells, because of course every operation with null by default in GIS, it should be, the result should be null. So what's the average value of the raster map which contains null? Oh, it's null. So well, this wouldn't be really useful. So the behavior in r.univar is that it's computing the statistics from non-null cells, but it will also report you the null cells. So the n, the number of non-null cells, is something, and since it is in the dictionary, we can do we can index it with n, and we are getting the number of cells. Let's do that, and then so that's the number of cells from here. And then, and we did this before, we are getting the current computational region, which contains east-west resolution and south-north somewhere? North-south here. So they are the same in this case, but they could be different, of course, because it the cell must be rectangular, but it does not have to be necessarily a square. So you should always check both. And what we are doing here is that we are getting these two values, multiplying them and multiplying it with the number of cells, which gives us the area of this in the whatever units it is. And these are meters because we are in North Carolina state plane meters location. So this gives us the area of the viewshed in square meters. And surprisingly, it's whatever is 10 times 10 times this number. Okay, so in getting so let me actually read it. The next task is to find and count the number of points contained in the input vector layer, which are visible from the current point. One way is to do this is to derive the vector layer of visible points by specially overlapping the input points with the viewshed for this CV select. The viewshed must be first converted to the vector map model. Vector data model with R2Vect. So the idea is that we have this viewshed from some particular point. I guess it's here, but I'm not so sure about it. And we want to see what other points can we see from this point. And the other points are the ones which we generated before with the vRandom module. In reality, of course, it wouldn't be randomly generated, but it would be something like houses or something. And we are interested in what other houses we can see from our house. Or maybe cell towers. All right. So what we do is that we convert the raster viewshed to vector as area, and to convert from raster to vector in GRASS there is r dot to dot vect. So in GRASS there is this system of the module names and dots. So all the modules which are dealing with rasters are called r dot something, and the modules which are converting things from one format or one representation to the other are called dot to dot something. So we have r dot to, and then we are converting raster to vector, so it's r dot to dot vect, so raster to vector. And then what we are doing is that we are selecting, so we select, it's like doing overlay analysis, or in this case, it is looking on the two vector maps, and when they overlap, it gives us the features from one, it gives us the things which overlap, which of course in case of areas and points are always the points if they are inside the area. So we input this viewshed, and then also the points and the input points in our case, that's what we generated with the vrandom function. And I guess we can view it. What it is? Visible points. It's in variable name, visible points. Oh. Well, let's use the name of the variable, right? And that's it. Okay, so there are some. I actually think that this function, right? I was saying that this function is just function which is in a file. This function is just in a file which is part of the workshop, so I'm not exactly sure how it is working, but I think that actually it's broken for showing vectors and rasters together, and I forgot about it before the workshop. So I can show either vectors or rasters. And the idea is that because people are using IPython notebook more and more, that we would actually fine-tune this function, or maybe some other with similar interface and functionality, and we would put it to GRASS, so then you would just import something from GRASS and use the function rather than like carrying around some custom file which is half broken and so on. But we are not there yet, so this has to be enough for now.
Looks like we're running out of time.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, well, it's getting more and more complicated. and that's probably even better if you just go it through yourself. So we are like then iterating over several points in a raster in the vector map. And then yeah, it's getting more and more complicated. So,
all right.
I
so,
guess
do you want to summarize what you've gotten through today?
Yeah, maybe. So the main idea of GRASS scripting is that you call GRASS modules, because that's where in GRASS there is all the functionality, and you can do all the tasks you want. You can do with GRASS modules. So you use these run command, write command, read command functions. And most of the time, you probably use run command function because you want to do some geospatial analysis and the results are just stored in the GRASS database. But time to time, if you are doing like some more complicated things, what you do is that you like manipulate particular cells in a raster, and raster algebra is not enough for you, or you manipulate the individual features in a vector map. So, and the standard operations are just not enough, or you want to somehow combine it or something. So in this case, you can use PyGRASS, where there is this nice interface, which is object-oriented, but it is also very fast because it's basically implemented in C. And then there is, and I was just talking about it at the beginning, like there are some ways how to make your script more powerful in the way that you will actually turn it into GRASS module, so that then you can get the benefits of like calling it nicely in Python, and also the other benefit is that you actually can generate nice graphical user interface, and this graphical user interface is not generated. Like you don't have to write like that here is a button and this button is something. You just say, oh, this is a raster map, and it will do everything for you. So that's very advantageous to look at it. And this is in the other parts of the material, and the material is online, so you can access it and go through it. And what you can, you don't necessarily have to use the IPython notebook. You can just use here Python shell in GRASS, and this will be the same. Or whatever you start from here, from the command line, you might, if you are lucky, it might work well in GRASS. On Linux, it will just work. On Windows, you will have to be lucky. That's it, probably.
All right, well, thank you so much.